Turkey's invasion of northern Syria following U.S. withdrawal of its troops means that all bets are now off in the Middle East. By invading northern Syria last week, Recep Tayyip Erdogan achieved what many thought impossible, uniting all the regional countries and rival powers with a stake in Syria in furious opposition to what they see as a reckless destabilizing move. Turkish aggression launched east of the Euphrates River last week is proceeding over a far more widespread area than its earlier illegal cross-border operations in Syria, so-called Euphrates Shield and Olive Branch. The newest Turkish aggression, dubbed Operation Peace Spring, has nothing to do with peace, nothing to do with protecting Turkey from cross-border attacks, nothing to do with combating ISIS and like-minded terrorist groups that Ankara supports. Erdogan's aggression has everything to do with wanting northern Syrian territory annexed to establish what he refers to as a safe zone for Syrian refugees that he wants to transfer from Turkey to Syrian territory controlled by his regime, especially the oil-producing territories in northern Syria. Turkish Foreign Minister Mevlut Çavuşoğlu turned truth on its head, claiming Operation Peace Spring is being carried out under international law, the UN Charter, and UN Security Council resolutions on the fight against terrorism. On the contrary, both U.S. and Turkish operations in Syria are flagrant U.N. Charter breaches. No nation may attack another preemptively except in self-defense if authorized by Security Council members, which did not happen in Syria. Even as the EU, the U.S., Russia, Iran, and the Arab states voiced their differing objections to the invasion, Erdogan turned a deaf ear. Anticipating Europe's hostile reaction, Erdogan's response was a threat to send 3.6 million Syrian refugees westward. Welcome to the Middle East Stream. I'm Marwa Osman. A Turkish invasion of northeastern Syria is likely to result in a high number of casualties in the near term and significant instability in the region in the longer term. We discuss today the implications of a Turkish invasion in northeastern Syria with Laith Maruf, political commentator and expert in Middle East politics. Thank you for being with us, Laith.
Thank you very much for having me.
Now, Turkish President Recep Tayyip Erdogan said that Turkey's aim from invading Syria is actually to combat Kurdish forces and to create some sort of a safe zone. Creating a safe zone for whom exactly, especially that this week we've been witnessing that the Syrian Arab Army has been taking control of bordering areas with Turkey for the first time in the past 8 years?
Well, that's a very big question. Since the Kurdish militias disbanded and now joined the Syrian army officially, there is no excuse on the table that could make sense. So what the unofficial reason that Turkey has invaded Syria is to actually occupy more territory and destabilize the Syrian government. Mm-hmm. Now, this is a big issue, not only for Syria itself, but for the whole world. Because if a country can illegally invade and occupy another sovereign state's territory, this is now a total end to the international law and the UN agreements that we know. Mm-hmm. So it started with Israel, but now it seems like to be
moving on to Turkey.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Well, in a series of tweets defending the latest decision taken by the U.S., the U.S. President Donald Trump, and I quote, he said that the U.S. has got deeper into battle with no aim in sight, and that Turkey, Europe, Syria, Iran, Iraq, Russia, and the Kurds will now have to figure the situation out. Do you agree that this is really the reason why Trump is leaving Syria, or might he have actually brokered a deal with Erdogan prior to him announcing this?
Well, the United States has been wanting to withdraw out of Syria for a long time. Actually, it goes back to the time of Obama. Mm-hmm. At the end of his term, Secretary of State Kerry signed the peace deal with Russia and announced that he is going to withdraw the troops from Syria. And as we know, at the time, there was a mutiny within the Pentagon, within the American Army, and the American Army armed forces bombed the Syrian army outside Deir ez-Zor city, mm-hmm. And allowed ISIS to attack the city that was under siege for, at that point, for 3 years. So we know that the actual, any politician that gets into power that is not beholden to Israeli or military circles within the United States will make the sensible decision that they have to get out of Syria, because there's no way you can defeat the Syrian army and the Syrian people without a total regional war. So this is what Trump has been saying that he wants to do from the beginning. This is what Obama was going to do at the end of his term. And now we see, it seems like that there is a mutiny against Trump also within the American establishment.
But he was keen on actually doing it without going back to any of the Pentagon leaders. And that was a first.
Yes, that was a first, but we see also that the movement of the American troops out of Syria is taking its time. And we saw that the battalion that was stationed around Manbij and around Ain al-Arab was almost mutinying and was delaying the withdrawal up until yesterday, when they finally had to leave, because the American Hercules heavy lifting planes were leaving without them.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Turks will simply not tolerate what they see as a threat posed by the Kurdish forces on the border with Syria. And they clearly said they are willing to move their forces as they did, and to bomb the area and to move even further inside Syrian territory. But wouldn't it, the actual U.S. withdrawal, wouldn't it be a good thing for the Turks to open up some sort of a dialogue with the Kurds? Because we didn't see that happening. At the same moment when the U.S. announced its withdrawal, Turkey began an invasion. It didn't even give time for the Kurds to start any sort of dialogue. Why did that happen?
Well, for Turkey, it's the Kurdish population is the biggest minority within Turkey, and any sovereignty or independence that could happen in Syria for Kurdish populations would be mean that this could actually spill into Turkey. The majority of the Kurdish population in the world lives in Turkey. There's not one piece of Syria that is actually indigenous Kurdish land. The indigenous Kurdish lands are the Kurdish mountains that are in Turkey. And so we know that this is a humongous threat to Turkish territorial unity to have any Kurdish militias stationed around its side that can claim sovereignty. So that's understandable that Turkey doesn't want that, and that's something also that Syria doesn't want. No Syrian would ever accept that Kurdish refugees that arrived and now are citizens that we accept as compatriots can take our land and call it a Kurdish state, especially that they are a minority in North Syria. They're not even close to 30% of the population. So that's understandable, but what's not understandable is that once the Syrian army had entered the territory, and once these Kurdish militias disbanded and joined the Syrian army, there's no more excuse. So what is left for us is to understand that Turkey is expanding. It wants to have a regional role that shows that it can do what Israel is doing, that it can achieve clobbering any resistance to international American rule. But at the same time, we can see that the Israeli lobby loves the Kurdish militias, and they're not happy that Turkey could be competing with or weakening their allies, the Kurdish militias. So the situation within what we can call an imperial domain or the imperial alliance that at one point included Turkey is now falling apart.
Exactly. Well, this is what I mean when I talk about the northern part of Syria led by the Turkish invasion is not going as well as Erdogan wants it to. Hundreds of thousands of Syrian natives from Kurds, Syrians and Arabs are fleeing the area, running away, being displaced because of this invasion. Scores have been killed and others have been injured as well because of this invasion. And on top of that, ISIS seems to rear its head again, also because of this invasion. How do you think Erdogan plans to fix all of this?
I don't think he has a plan to fix things. What his plan is that he wants to have a say in the future of Syria. His militias that he controlled, the other Wahhabi militias other than ISIS that he controlled within Idlib and northern Aleppo, their end was coming very fast. The Syrian army was going to definitely take back Idlib and North Aleppo any minute before this new invasion happened in Hasaka and Raqqa. So what is clear is that Erdogan wanted a new chip, or a new bargaining chip, for him to be able to have say in the future of Syria. Syrian government's not going to accept that. Mm-hmm. Let's see what Russia will do in the next few days. Would it, when the confrontation happens, and it is already starting between the Syrian army and the Turkish army, where will Russia stand?
That's the major question here. Will we see any sort of clashes between both armies, the Syrian army and the Turkish invasion?
Well, in the last few hours, and in today specifically, Turkish artillery started shelling Syrian army in Minbij, and also drones, Turkish drones have been hitting the Syrian army on the M4 highway that cuts through North Syria. So things are moving very fast, and because there is none of the things that we have been used to in terms of checks and balances are all off the table. Things could go ways that nobody expects.
I want to thank you very much, Laith Maarouf, political analyst and expert in Middle East politics, for joining us and for your contribution about this matter. Thank you for being with us. Please stay tuned for the next segment.
Very surprised at this accusation. I even thought of actually approaching Turkish intelligence, and because I have nothing to hide and I've never done anything aside from my job.
Remembering Press TV's Lebanese-American journalist Serena Shim, who was killed in Turkey in 2014 for revealing the truth regarding the relationship between Turkey and Daesh. Given that Turkish intelligence threatened Serena, according to her testimony, and that Turkey is notorious for its worldwide image imprisoning journalists, and the U.S. State Department and the mainstream media's lack of concern is also incriminating against this issue of Serena. Let us all remember Serena Shim in this following report. Journalist Serena Shim had announced she was working on a report including videos showing the involvement of the World Food Program in transporting Daesh members between Turkey and Syria. However, this story was never released. The journalist died after her car was hit by a heavy vehicle on the Syrian border. Her cameraman was seriously injured and the videotapes disappeared. Shim, a 29-year-old American journalist of Lebanese descent and mother of two, who worked for the Iranian news channel Press TV, had been covering the ongoing war on Syria in October 2014 when she passed away. Specifically, the battle between ISIS militants and Kurdish forces near the Syrian town of Ain al-Arab Kobani, from the Turkish-Syrian border. Shim was traveling in a rental car back to her hotel after reporting from the Turkish town of Suruj near the Syrian border when the car was allegedly struck by a heavy vehicle, killing Shim. The suspicious death of U.S.-born journalist Serena Shim and the deafening silence on the story in the U.S. was merely the loudest example of the blatant double standard employed by the Western mainstream media. While Turkish authorities quickly contended that her death was an accident, many around the world, including executives and Syrian staff members of Press TV, had expressed doubts about the circumstances of her death, describing it as suspicious. Such suspicions are clearly warranted as the alleged accident came just one day after Shin expressed fears for her own safety after receiving death threats from Turkish intelligence MIT.
However, I am a bit worried because, as you know, and as the viewers know, that Turkey has been labeled by Reporters Without Borders as the largest prison for journalists. So I am a bit frightened about what they might use against me. We were some of the first people on the ground, if not the first people, to get that story of those Tafiri militants going in through the Turkish border from the Beb el-Hawa. I'm very surprised at this accusation. I even thought of actually approaching Turkish intelligence, and because I have nothing to hide and I've never done anything aside from my job.
Remembering Press TV's Lebanese-American journalist Serena Shim, who was killed in Turkey in 2014 for revealing the truth regarding the relationship between Turkey and Daesh. Given that Turkish intelligence threatened Serena according to her testimony, and that Turkey is notorious worldwide for its imprisonment and murder of journalists, the U.S. State Department's and mainstream media's lack of concern is incriminating in itself. Let us remember Serena Shim in this following report. Journalist Serena Shim had announced she was working on a report including videos showing the involvement of the World Food Program in transporting Daesh members between Turkey and Syria. However, this story was never released. The journalist died after her car was hit by a heavy vehicle on the Syrian border. Her cameraman was seriously injured and the videotapes disappeared. Shim, a 29-year-old American journalist of Lebanese descent and mother of two, who worked for the Iranian news channel Press TV, had been covering the ongoing war on Syria in October 2014 when she passed away, specifically the battle between ISIS militants and Kurdish forces near the Syrian town of Ain al-Arab Kobani from the Turkish-Syrian border. Shim was traveling in a rental car back to her hotel after reporting from the Turkish town of Suruj near the Syrian border when the car was allegedly struck by a heavy vehicle, killing Shim. The suspicious death of U.S.-born journalist Serena Shim and the deafening silence on the story in the U.S. was merely the loudest example of the blatant double standard employed by the Western mainstream media. While Turkish authorities quickly contended that her death was an accident, many around the world, including executives and Syrian staff members of Press TV, had expressed doubts about the circumstances of her death, describing it as suspicious. Such suspicions are clearly warranted as the alleged accident came just one day after Shim expressed fears for her own safety after receiving death threats from Turkish intelligence MIT.
However, I am a bit worried because, as you know, and as the viewers know, that Turkey has been labeled by Reporters Without Borders as the largest prison for journalists. So I am a bit frightened about what they might use against me. Some of the first people on the ground, if not the first people, to get that story of those Tafiri militants going in through the Turkish border from the Beb el-Hawa Rihanli border being sent in. I got images of them in World Food Organization trucks.
This revealing interview highlights the fact that Shim, unlike many Western journalists reporting on the war on Syria, was actually involved in a serious investigation, including documenting the collusion between Turkish intelligence and militant extremists to smuggle fighters and weapons into Syria. Shim was on the ground covering the story, getting documentary evidence, including photos and videos of the militants in NGO trucks, a blatant violation of international law. It is precisely this damning evidence of Turkey's involvement in the Syrian war that likely sparked the death threats against her, quite likely led to her possible assassination. To discuss the issue of journalist Serena Shim with us from Beirut is Mariam Saleh, Press TV's correspondent from Beirut. Thank you for joining us, Mariam, especially to talk about Serena, one of us. Now, 5 years have passed since the martyrdom of Serena Shim. There are very few reports about Serena's tragic death, but nothing like the kind of reporting about a brave young journalist that one would actually expect. Was this because the story she was covering was so dangerous that a NATO ally of the West, like Turkey, should be cooperating with ISIS? Was that reason that this story has never been widely spread?
Well, we can say that this is one of the reasons, because as you know, the infiltration of militants was present throughout the borders, whether from Turkey or from Lebanon, and many states were implicated, and many reports have said this, but there wasn't actually hands-on evidence, if you may say. So the journalists that really did see and were able to collect this information to show the implication of those states, it really felt that they were threatened, and Serena was definitely one of them. And one of the reasons also why her story wasn't covered is that at that time especially, there was a lot of blackout, so much blackout and covering of events and situations. And we said there were big, huge states implicated in this issue, mm-hmm. in the infiltration of these Takfiri militants and these terrorists that were going into Syria in the millions, perhaps in thousands, and they were as some were called them, they were monsters going into Syria, mm-hmm. To try to change the course of events, to try to change the face of the region. And now, as we look at the situation inside Syria and what's happening, I think that many of the journalists paid their life for the fact to show that what was happening inside Syria was definitely not what the mainstream media was giving you and was trying to put in the hearts of people, in the minds of people all over the world. And I think we got the news from Syria, from the Turkish side, mm-hmm. That was very significant, because Turkey is considered, and we can see today from its aggression on Syria, how it is one of the stakeholders, if we may say, mm-hmm. In the Syrian crisis.
Well, the broadcasting headquarters of the national TVs and international TVs in Syria, if you go to that building, you could see a big poster with hundreds of journalists, whether Syrian or Arab journalists, who were martyred in Syria while trying to get the word out and give us more information about what's going on the ground. Now, in 30 seconds, I would just like to talk more about the understanding the profoundness of the last 5 minutes that Serena was giving out as a live link from via Skype from Turkey, just less than 24 hours before she was murdered. As such, it has proven today that the road map to this geopolitical reality that has already been foretold by her death, for me it feels like her death was actually a warning to other journalists not to step way into the area where the big brothers, the big powers, would not want us to be reporting about. I mean, how do you assess this, given that the history of the mainstream media, throughout the continuous Western backing wars initiated in the Middle East, how do you assess that this would affect journalists? Would they be fearful of going back to the field and reporting?
Well, I think that it depends on the journalists themselves. I think many of the journalists would feel fearful, but if they were journalists like Serena Shim, who had a belief, they had a belief that they had a cause, and journalism, I think, even for journalists who understand mm-hmm. the meaning of journalism, it is a cause, and mm-hmm. and some of them are transformed into activists rather than being journalists, and mm-hmm. and they are asked to be neutral. What does neutral mean when you're trying to tell the truth? Definitely. And so this is one of the various issues that you can tell from journalists, if they continue despite the fact that they are going to be mm-hmm. Under threat, and this we all feared for Serena, and we did not expect things to reach that state, mm-hmm. but she was, I think, not someone who would discourage journalists. She would encourage more journalists that are free, that are Definitely. Independent and
to
really
step
want
forward
to
and
the truth.
Keep
yes.
reporting the truth. I want to thank you very much, Mariam Saleh, Press TV's Beirut correspondent. Thank you very much for joining us to talk about the contributions of Serena Shim and her powerful message to journalists everywhere. Thank you for being with us, and thank you for watching. Please stay tuned next week for more from the Middle East Stream.